Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Watch Basketball Like a Genius. What game designers, economists, ballet choreographers, and theoretical astrophysicists reveal about the greatest game on Earth. By Nick Greene. Narrated by Michael Butler Murray. Prologue. It comes in peace. In July 2020, the New York Times published a report suggesting the United States military is in possession of alien technologies, including materials retrieved from UFO crash sites. An astrophysicist working with the Pentagon went on record and said that he had issued a classified briefing in March, asserting the recovered materials were from off-world vehicles not made on this Earth. You may have missed this story about a potential interplanetary Cold War. I know I did. It came out in the middle of a summer beset by plague and chaos and got lost in the shuffle. America was exhausted. The aliens would have to check back in with us later. The Times published a short follow-up piece, essentially to say, "We can't believe we have to reiterate the alien news to you people." It didn't contain much new info, but the reporters further explained their sourcing. Numerous associates of the Pentagon program with high security clearances and decades of involvement with official UFO investigations told us they were convinced such crashes have occurred, based on their access to classified information. But the retrieved materials themselves and any data about them are completely off limits to anyone without clearances and a need to know. How exactly do they decide who gets to take a gander at this alien junk? I'm not talking about security clearances, but rather the specific kinds of expertise deemed appropriate to the task of combing through the detritus of an extraterrestrial crash site. Physicists and materials scientists are obvious and necessary participants, as they are prepared to analyze the alloys or polymers or whatever this stuff may be. But the mystery goes beyond simply identifying properties of matter. As a species, we are very new to this sort of thing. I'd hate to see us limit our options. What if the aliens were moving to a new planet when an armoire fell out of their spacecraft and tumbled to Earth? Maybe a glowing heap at a crash site is actually a pile of otherworldly pants and overalls. But we have no clue, because the military didn't ask a fashion designer or textile manufacturer to weigh in with their thoughts. Are the Pentagon's astrophysicists prepared to identify a pair of jaunty culottes? This is a legitimate concern. Think for a moment about the reverse scenario. Humans haven't sent any physical objects far enough to realistically believe that they'll bump into the home planets of other intelligent beings. But our radio and television signals travel at high enough speeds to reach thousands of nearby star systems. It is a very real possibility that aliens living light years away are just starting to enjoy our old programming. They might be tuning into Game 7 of the 1984 NBA Finals as you listen to this. How would those extraterrestrials approach basketball? Barring the extreme cosmic coincidence that they developed an identical version of the sport independently and without our influence, the aliens wouldn't have any hoops analysts or former players to help explain what's happening. They'd be forced to formulate their budding expertise regarding crossovers, reverse layups, and three-pointers on observation alone. I hope the alien powers that be let everyone, and not just their most esteemed scientists, watch hoops. The game was designed to be enjoyed by all. Basketball is a relatively recent invention. It didn't crash land on Earth until the late 19th century, and it didn't arrive fully formed. The sport has undergone constant changes throughout its brief life, many of which were thought up by people who could not be described as basketball experts, especially in its early days, when that distinction did not yet exist. Despite its ever-evolving form, there remains a unique pull to the game that transcends routine fandom. Much like the Beatles' discography or Sandra Bullock's performance in Speed, basketball is maximally appealing to a staggeringly large audience. It's as if we're preconditioned in the womb to embrace it. While I can't remember the first time I saw the game being played, I am confident that my underdeveloped cerebral cortex responded warmly, "This must be basketball. It's rather nice." I live in the Bay Area, which was the center of the basketball universe for the better part of a decade, thanks to the success of the Golden State Warriors. Naturally, all anyone wants to talk about is basketball. I tend to cover sports for work, but I've long balanced that beat with writing on a whole slew of topics. As a result, I have found myself discussing hoops with concert harpists, cat behaviorists, and plasma physicists. I initially considered this to be small talk, common ground to explore before we got to the nitty-gritty of their respective fields. But it quickly became apparent that, if they had their druthers, we'd spend hours talking about Steph Curry. These are people who don't think like the athletes playing the sport, or like the writers covering it. For example, a wine critic once told me she thought that noted enophile LeBron James would make a good vineyard owner, because he's a multitasker who prefers to delegate on the fly, and that his history with erratic teammates, like J.R. Smith, would come in handy when harvesting in unpredictable weather. This hypothetical vineyard stewardship was some of the most apt analysis I've encountered in all my years following basketball. Score one for viticulture. We all watch basketball differently. Not only did this realization help me build a greater appreciation for what had already been my favorite sport, but it also sparked the idea for this book. If one person's unique perspective on the game can help expand my own, what else have I been missing? I'm no genius, but I knew well enough to assume there was much more to learn. This book will not make you a better basketball player. How could it? Its author can barely dribble to his left. And I want to get that embarrassing fact out of the way early, lest anyone who is familiar with my handles comes forward to initiate a public shaming. Nevertheless, I still love the sport. It just works. Whether as a whole or broken down to its disparate parts, basketball has something for everyone. The question of how and why the game remains compelling cannot be answered from a single point of view. The NBA may never invite a ballet choreographer to judge its annual slam dunk contest, and you probably won't hear a magician analyze Kyrie Irving's handles on SportsCenter. But these surprising founts of basketball wisdom are worth listening to. With this in mind, I sought out some of the smartest and most interesting people I could find and approached them with the same simple request. Would you like to talk about basketball? I'm unsure whether the chemists, professors, casting directors, philosophers, and everyone else who agreed to chat about hoops thought they were going to greatly broaden my own understanding of how the game works. But each and every one managed to do just that. What follows is an attempt to collect and contextualize all those little epiphanies so that I can share them with you. Who knows? If this goes well, maybe they'll let us take a crack at those UFOs, too. Section 1. The Shape of the Game. Topics discussed in this section: where basketball comes from, grievous bodily harm, Reese's Puffs cereal, board games, facial hair, nominalism, dribbling, close-up magic, cheating, chain smoking, the shot clock, bowling alleys, PBA Rule 17.6.2.B, Superman, school dances, maps, Faith Baptist Bible College, management consulting, traffic signals. Topics not discussed in this section: where babies come from, the 1988 Democratic Convention, fly fishing, bubble tea, acupuncture, Pangea, artificial intelligence, millinery, wheat allergies, calligraphy, the Olestra diarrhea panic of 1996, pointillism, Rick Steves Europe, baccarat, Pliny the Elder, Fog Hat, Pliny the Younger, Train Ferries, The Different Types of Clouds. An Introductory Class. Naismith's Original 13 Rules for Basketball. There are two wildly dissimilar stories about the first ever basketball game. In one telling, it went off without a hitch. In the other, players were nearly murdered. It's important to consider sourcing when assessing validity. But that only confuses things here because both versions come from the same guy, James Naismith, the man who invented the sport. Let's start with the murder story because it's obviously more interesting. In 1939, Naismith was interviewed about the birth of basketball for a radio program called We the People. The audio, which was unearthed from the WOR-AM archives in 2015, remains the only known recording of Naismith's voice. He was 77 at the time of his appearance, and sounds grandfatherly and kind. Sadly, he died 10 months after the interview. It's a rather polished performance, and Naismith regales the studio audience with the story of how he tamed a class of incorrigibles he was tasked with teaching at the YMCA training school in Springfield, Massachusetts, on December 21, 1891. "We had a real New England blizzard," Naismith says. "For days, the students couldn't go outdoors, so they began roughhousing in the halls." He then explains how, after an unsuccessful attempt at indoor football, he came up with a totally fresh sport for the co-opted students to play. Basketball. "What rules did you have for your new game, Dr. Naismith?" asks Gabriel Heater, the show's host. "Well, I didn't have enough, and that's where I made my big mistake," Naismith says. "The boys began tackling, kicking, and punching. They ended up in a free-for-all in the middle of the gym floor. Before I could pull them apart, one boy was knocked out, several of them had black eyes, and one had a dislocated shoulder. It certainly was murder." Heater chuckles, and Naismith continues. "After that first match, I thought they'd kill each other, but they kept nagging me to let them play again." Naismith explains that, thanks to the addition of a few rules, basketball became the fine, clean sport that would soon take the world by storm. "I guess it just goes to show what you can do if you have to," he says. The audience then bursts into applause, and the orchestra plays him out. It's a lively story, but it's difficult to reconcile with what he wrote in his memoir, which was published 2 years after his death and 3 years after the radio appearance. "The game was a success from the first time that ball was tossed up." We know that some elements of his violent We the People story are true. Naismith really was tasked with keeping a class of rowdy jerks dubbed the Incorrigibles active and entertained. Their previous physical education teacher, a retired circus performer, failed to get the students interested in calisthenics and gymnastics, and Naismith theorized that the young men craved competition and needed to fulfill a play instinct. He tried to modify football and soccer for the indoors, but the former was too violent, and the latter led to errant kicks that frequently knocked dumbbells off their wall racks. "It was a practical lesson in first aid," Naismith wrote. His solution was a game that involved tossing a ball into peach baskets nailed to the gym's balcony. Naismith does allude to violence in his book. He had struggled to come up with a method to start each basketball game, and in writing about his invention of the opening tip-off, he recalls that he had figured there would be little chance for roughness if he selected one player per side. Despite it being the fairest way to start, he admits he seriously underestimated the ingenuity of the American boy. Could those early tip-offs have inspired the brutal, Braveheart-like battle he describes on the radio? The book contains no mention of unconscious students or shoulders pulled from sockets, and while good writing may be concise, the omission of such juicy details would frustrate even the most succinct stylists. It's possible that Naismith, in an attempt to tell an entertaining tale on the radio, embellished the roughhousing that transpired and condensed it into an allegorical fable about rules facilitating peace. Besides being a teacher and a medical doctor, Naismith was also a Presbyterian minister, and it's easy to imagine why that kind of story would appeal to him. The embellishment may have also been down to the fact that the first game was extremely boring. It finished with a score of 1-0, and a student named William Chase hit the only basket on a desperate heave from 25 feet. All shots were worth 1 point. The gymnasium floor measured 35 by 44 feet, meaning the first successful shot in hoops history was from nearly midcourt. Besides this Steph Curry-like anomaly, that inaugural game was clumsy, if not entirely chaotic. There was no teamwork, but each man did his best, Naismith wrote of his guinea pigs. His students greatly enjoyed the new sport, even if they stunk at it. In other words, if you ever obtain access to a time machine, don't waste it on a trip to Springfield, Massachusetts, in 1891, to watch the first basketball game. Go somewhere warm instead. Florida, before it became Florida, perhaps? If you really want to bear witness to the birth of basketball, you'll have to use your imagination. Here are a few key visual cues that may help paint a picture of this particular New England moment. Amazing facial hair, including a good number of jaunty walrus mustaches. Descriptions of the Springfield affair sometimes juvenilized the students, but they were hardly boys, as Naismith called them during his radio appearance. The class was full of scruffy college-aged men who were trying to be YMCA secretaries. In the 1930s, a committee of physical education administrators wanted to recreate that first game at a convention, but Naismith thought they would have trouble finding 18 young men with proper facial adornment in those modern times, and denied permission. They too would have to settle for their imaginations. An extremely crowded court. Each team had 9 men per side, and everyone played at the same time. Substitutions weren't invented until the following year, after a game at Cornell featured more than 100 players on the floor at once. The teacher there cut the contest short because, as Naismith writes, there was a danger of serious damage to the building. Those peach baskets. Naismith wanted boxes, 18 inches square, but the YMCA building superintendent could only supply 2 round baskets from the storeroom. Naismith nailed them to the lower balcony railings on each side of the gym. They happen to be 10 feet high. And that measurement is one of the only facets of the game that has remained consistent throughout the sport's history. Modern rims, as a matter of coincidence, are 18 inches in diameter. A stepladder propped against the wall. The baskets lacked holes in their bottoms, and in the event of a made shot, Naismith's assistant would climb a small ladder to retrieve the ball. Successful shots were a rarity in basketball's early days, and there is at least one recorded instance of a ball retriever becoming so bored during a game that he left the gym and caused a delay. The game itself. It was static and looked nothing like basketball as we know it. Seems odd, but that's exactly how Naismith drew it up. Naismith's game sprouted from a restriction. He believed the best way to curtail violence was to prevent players from moving when in possession of the ball. In his book, he describes this realization as a eureka moment that begat the rest of his sport. I sat erect at my desk and said aloud, if he can't run with the ball, we don't have to tackle. And if we don't have to tackle, the roughness will be eliminated. I can still recall how I snapped my fingers and shouted, I've got it! You'll probably notice that this epiphany is in direct opposition to the spirit of modern basketball. In fact, only a few of Naismith's original rules are essential or even applicable to the game as it is played today. The no-running edict became Rule 3, and everything else grew from there. It took Naismith about an hour to jot down the outline for his invention, and he pinned the list of rules to the gymnasium's bulletin board before the incorrigibles gathered for their 11:30 a.m. class. 1. The ball may be thrown in any direction with one or both hands. 2. The ball may be batted in any direction with one or both hands, never with the fist. 3. A player cannot run with the ball. The player must throw it from the spot on which he catches it. Allowance to be made for a man who catches the ball when running at a good speed, 4. The ball must be held in or between the hands. The arms or body must not be used for holding it. 5. No shouldering, holding, pushing, tripping, or striking in any way. The person of an opponent shall be allowed. The first infringement of this rule by any player shall count as a foul. The second shall disqualify him until the next goal is made. Or if there was evident intent to injure the person, for the whole of the game, no substitute allowed. 6. A foul is striking at the ball with the fist, violation of Rule 3, 4, and such as described in Rule 5. 7. If either side makes 3 consecutive fouls, it shall count as a goal for the opponents. Consecutive means without the opponents in the meantime making a foul. 8. A goal shall be made when the ball is thrown or batted from the grounds into the basket and stays there, providing those defending the goal do not touch or disturb the goal. If the ball rests on the edge and the opponent moves the basket, it shall count as a goal. 9. When the ball goes out of bounds, it shall be thrown into the field of play by the person first touching it. In case of a dispute, the umpire shall throw it straight into the field. The thrower in is allowed 5 seconds. If he holds it longer, it shall go to the opponent. If any side persists in delaying the game, the umpire shall call a foul on that side. 10. The umpire shall be judge of the men and shall note the fouls and notify the referee when 3 consecutive fouls have been made. He shall have power to disqualify men according to Rule 5. 11. The referee shall be judge of the ball and shall decide when the ball is in play, in bounds, to which side it belongs, and shall keep the time. He shall decide when a goal has been made and keep account of the goals with any other duties that are usually performed by a referee. 12. The time shall be 2 15-minute halves with 5 minutes rest between. 13. The side making the most goals in that time shall be declared the winner. In case of a draw, the game may, by agreement of the captains, be continued until another goal is made. Let's ignore the content of these rules for a moment, so we can better appreciate them as a historical document. What Naismith accomplished is truly astounding. Football, baseball, soccer, and hockey all evolved over centuries from various folk games. Basketball, meanwhile, sprouted from the brain of a 30-year-old Canadian gym teacher shortly after breakfast. Even the world's most seductive religions and cults would envy how fast and far Naismith's game has spread. Basketball is the second most popular sport in the world to play. In 2017, nearly 190 million people watched the NBA Finals in China, and that number only accounts for those who viewed the games on their mobile phones. Not bad for a guy who was just trying to keep 18 mustachioed jerks entertained for an hour. The Incorrigibles were the first to fall in love with basketball, and they took to the sport immediately. The students introduced it to friends at home during winter break, and requests soon filtered in from around the country for the official rules. In January 1982, the YMCA newspaper The Triangle printed Naismith's instructions under the headline, "A New Game." More requests came in, but this time they were for clarification. The Triangle's editors forgot to specify the kind of ball that should be used. It was a soccer ball. They also left out the court's measurements and the fact that the baskets were to be elevated. Who knows what kind of bizarre games were being played in YMCAs across the country before those omissions were corrected. But none of it mattered in the long run. The game was an instant hit. Somehow. Put yourself in the position of a YMCA administrator or student in the late 19th century. You open the newspaper and read Naismith's rules. Do they make you want to drop what you're doing, pick up an unspecified ball and, in the words of its creator, bat it from the grounds into a basket? I must admit that, to my untrained eyes, Naismith's original game doesn't exactly capture the imagination. It's halting. There are too many ejections. The umpire essentially maintains power of attorney over the players. Surely I must be missing something, for Aristotelian logic proves that Naismith's original rules were engaging. 1. Students at the YMCA would have stopped playing basketball if they weren't having fun. Two? That was 1891. It is currently the 21st century, and I am writing a book about basketball. Three? Therefore, basketball was fun in 1891. As countless ancient Athenians can attest, there's no use in arguing with Aristotle. I'm clearly reading the rules incorrectly. Even the incorrigibles were able to properly interpret and turn them into a good time. What about Naismith's design exactly was divine? Games are peculiar things. They are the only pursuit in which rules are used to facilitate fun. That's the goal. And those who create games must dole and winnow restrictions like a chef picking ingredients. Game designer as a job title didn't exist in 1891, but Naismith fit that description to a T. College students can major in game design nowadays, and if they do, Eric Zimmerman might be one of their professors. He teaches at NYU's Game Center and is a co-founder and the CEO of Game Lab, the first video game studio to receive a grant from the MacArthur Foundation. Zimmerman rose to prominence designing computer games. His most famous creation is the mid-aughts PC hit, Diner Dash. But he teaches his students how to make games in all types of media, starting with basic board games. I sent him the original 13 rules for basketball to gauge whether or not Naismith nailed it on his first try. From a design point of view, I think it's interesting, Zimmerman says. From a presentational point of view, if a student turned this in, I would tell them they need to do some work on these. If you think about a tabletop game, the rule book is a whole experience. True, the list Naismith pinned to the YMCA bulletin board was hardly eye-catching. But he wasn't interested in art. He just wanted to keep his students from cold-cocking each other. I'm not criticizing him, Zimmerman says. I'm just making an observation that these rules are clearly functional in that sense. For a game designer, the word functional sheds its utilitarian connotation and instead refers to something much more enjoyable. One of the paradoxes of game design is that the creativity of play is made possible by play's opposite, which are rules, he says. Rules are in essence constraints, but games don't feel that way. Basketball is an amazing example of this. When the rules are activated, what follows is fluid, unpredictable magic. If you read the rules, you would never guess that's what emerges. But Naismith's original rules resulted in clumsy, low-scoring affairs. Where does the magic come in? Zimmerman gives his classes an assignment, where they try to improve tic-tac-toe. He asks them to write out the game's existing rules on the whiteboard, and then has them brainstorm gameplay adjustments that will, ideally, create a totally new experience. My favorite variation was when the students altered just one rule. If you get three in a row, you lose. It was a small tweak, but it completely changed everything. I just thought it was so elegant. A game becomes exponentially more fun once its players learn to get creative within its boundaries. It's less about following the rules and more about filling in the gaps that exist between them. Zimmerman uses poker as an example. There's nothing in the rules about bluffing, he says. There's not a rule that says you can lie if you don't have a good hand. It's intrinsic to the system. Bluffing is an emergent property that appears out of the negative space of the rules. For a game designer, this is everything. It's how a snow day diversion evolves into a global phenomenon. I'm getting chills just talking about it, he says. With his background in video game design, Zimmerman is attuned to seeing games as products. And basketball's journey through the marketplace follows a familiar path. If you think about it, the YMCA was the platform for that game in the way that a Nintendo Switch is a platform for a piece of software, he says. As we say in the game industry, there was an embedded base. Had Naismith invented basketball outside the purview of the YMCA's worldwide network, it could have remained a regional curiosity and fizzled into obscurity. Nevertheless, some YMCAs weren't prepared to handle this incredibly popular new game. The Philadelphia chapter banned basketball because participants and spectators overcrowded its facilities. Administrators eventually reinstated the sport when they realized it also functioned as their most successful recruitment tool. This early reach wasn't limited to America. One of Naismith's classmates at the training school, Genzabaro Ishikawa, was from Japan, and he returned home with a guide to basketball. There is evidence that the game was played there as early as 1900. China, meanwhile, enjoyed the sport even before Japan, and it was introduced to the country in 1895 after a YMC opened in Tianjin. When basketball first appeared in the Olympics in 1936, a Chinese referee officiated the gold medal game between Canada and the United States. Naismith was in attendance in Berlin and happily noted that there was not a single questioning of the officials' rulings by the players. It was one of his favorite aspects of what must have been a surreal event for Naismith. Here was a referee who was born 7,000 miles away from the Springfield YMCA, and he's interpreting a version of the game rules Naismith had jotted down 45 years before that trip to Europe. That moment of harmony also served as a sort of spiritual opposition to the horrendous backdrop of those Olympics. Nothing in Naismith's personal life would suggest that his journey to Europe was in any way an endorsement of the event's hosts. Back home, he had long been staunchly against segregation and personally mentored John McClendon, University of Kansas's first black physical education major, and the man who would eventually break the color barrier as a professional basketball coach. To Naismith, the Olympics were above all a profoundly personal experience, and he couldn't hide his tears when teams from the Philippines, Uruguay, Estonia, and other nations took turns applauding him in the stands during a tip-off ceremony. Basketball is kind of a turning point in the history of games, Zimmerman says. It occurred at a pivotal moment. In the 20th century, games gradually became authored media. They became something that's ascribed to a person or a team of people who made it. Naismith had none of this in mind when he introduced the sport to his students on that snowy day in Springfield. In his book, he recalls that Frank Mahan, one of the rowdier incorrigibles, suggested the game be called Naismith Ball. The teacher demurred and joked that this would immediately kill any interest in the activity. "Why not call it basketball?" the student asked. He nailed it. Colleen Macklin loves Naismith's first rule. The ball may be thrown in any direction, with one or both hands. She is a professor at the Parsons School of Design and the director of Pet Lab, an organization that develops experimental games for learning. It's some pretty heady stuff, which seems to be her specialty. "Lately, I've been trying to make games that are ambient or in the background," she says. "I'm currently working on a game you play when you're not playing anything. You basically take weird topics and try to subtly weave them into conversation without anyone realizing it." I don't think she uses our phone call as an opportunity to play her creation, unless that means that I have already lost the game. I read her basketball's first rule, and the wheels start spinning. "Already I'm thinking about what I can do," she says. The rule follows a durable tenet of game design, one she credits to USC professor Tracy Fullerton. Begin with, what does a player get to do? What you're looking for with a game is spontaneity, Macklin says. You want players to do things you didn't expect. Surprise is fun. Naismith loved it when his students got creative, so long as they didn't knock each other unconscious. And he thought that basketball was uniquely suited to improve a person's ability to react to the unknown. "It is impossible to tell what an expert opponent will do," he writes in his book. "A player must react to the conditions without time for deliberation. He cannot depend on the coach, but must face the emergency himself." Both Zimmerman and Macklin refer me to The Heresy of Zone Defense, an essay by art critic Dave Hickey that is especially revered by game designers. Zimmerman says it's one of the best things ever written on the subject. What does an art critic think about basketball? Well, for one thing, Hickey wishes art was more like Naismith's sport. In writing about Julius Erving's famous behind-the-backboard layup from the 1980 NBA Finals. He examines how this spontaneous response to restrictive elements of the game, defense, the backboard, the out-of-bounds borders, etc., created a moment of joy. Fans witnessed the triumph of civil society in an act that was clearly the product of talent and will, accommodating itself to liberating rules. Hickey flows from Dr. J to Jackson Pollock's drip paintings and explains how the latter's artist's act of defiance eventually become a prohibitive institutional edict taught in art schools. Following the rules can be groovy, but only if they're enforced for the right reasons. The trick of civilization lies in recognizing the moment when a rule ceases to liberate and begins to govern, Hickey writes. Basketball has been supreme in recognizing this moment of portending government and in deflecting it. In evolving to welcome these liberating forces, Naismith's sport manages to out-avant-garde the avant-garde. Once you learn what to watch in this game, basically everything, it is civilized complexity incarnate, quite literally made flesh, Hickey argues. This is not to say that basketball is a religion. It is better than a religion. As such, a successful game welcomes change. Macklin and Zimmerman worked together, along with John Sharp, to create the Metagame, a card game about games that was originally intended to be played by game designers at a game design conference, hence Meta. In some ways, it's the opposite of basketball. Whereas Naismith wrote his rules by purposefully avoiding or countering specific aspects of other sports, the Metagame absorbs and pays homage to a myriad of different titles. Naismith removed the contact from football and the kicking from soccer. And while he momentarily considered using a lacrosse net, he instead opted for the goal to be on a horizontal plane in order to encourage delicate parabolic throws. The Metagame, meanwhile, can incorporate the guessing of charades, the questions of trivial pursuit, and the subjective zaniness of apples to apples. Macklin and Zimmerman worked on this creation for about a decade, and they still release updates online. We have 100 versions, Macklin tells me. Literally. The start of the design process was clear, but when exactly is it finished? When is any game finished? What you're trying to do is carve a narrow set of rules out of a possibility space that's multidimensional. So it's pretty challenging to get to the point where something is done, Macklin says. You know when a game is done when the date comes that you've promised to deliver it. Kind of a facetious answer, but it's actually true. In fact, the director of the Springfield YMCA gave Naismith 2 weeks to tame the incorrigibles, and he wrote the rules for basketball right at the end of his deadline. While Naismith's project was delivered on time, it will never be finished. It is with this thought that Macklin mentions Dave Hickey's wonderful essay about Dr. J, art, and religion. The art critic argues that the perpetual evolution of basketball and its rules is special because the changes are usually made in the interest of aesthetics. That is amazing when you think about it, Macklin says. A lot of game rules are modified or changed based on what the player wants. Basketball rules are modified in order to make the game more interesting to the spectator. When she watches basketball, she sees players both following and exploiting rules for the benefit of us fans. The result, she says, is one of the most beautiful things you can see. Macklin loves Hickey's example of the Dr. J behind the backboard layup, as it alludes to the kinds of decisions game designers must make. When it happened, she says, everyone was like, oh my God, we've never seen such a graceful move before. And so you have a choice there. The NBA could either say it's not allowed, or they could be like, yeah, let's let that happen. The right choice is obviously, let's let that happen. Despite his humble expectations, Naismith always wanted to create something that was pleasing to the eye. Basketball would have a definite place in a program of physical education, he wrote. First, because it is attractive. It worked. Within 2 weeks of the first game, Around 200 spectators filled the YMCA gallery to watch Naismith's class. Backboards, the impediment Dr. J so gracefully transcended, were actually invented in response to the sport's overwhelming popularity. Obnoxious fans so frequently reached over the balcony to swat away goal-bound shots that physical blockades had to be installed. By interfering with games in the 1890s, fans inadvertently established the conditions under which one of the sport's most incredible moments could occur nearly 100 years in the future. That's one hell of an assist. Not all of Naismith's ideas were winners, and as we're chatting, Zimmerman zeroes in on an obvious dud. One of the rules that struck me was, when the ball goes out of bounds, it shall be thrown into the field and played by the person first touching it. Does that mean that you just go running for the ball? He is referring to Rule 9, which is indeed a juicy slice of madness. Considering the explicitly stated goals of basketball was to keep players from colliding into one another, it's rather surprising that there would be a rule that calls for a total melee whenever the ball leaves the field of play. In his book, Naismith wrote about the pitfalls of this rule and how a student named Lloyd Ware took great pleasure, when in a jovial mood, in exhibiting a scar that he got when he dived for the ball and came into contact with the sharp corner of a radiator. During an early YMCA game, the ball landed in the balcony, and one team sprinted up the stairwell to go get it. As Naismith remembered it, two of the players on the other team boosted one of their mates up until he could catch the lower part of the balcony, swing himself up, and regain the out-of-bounds ball. The rule was soon tweaked to award possession to the player holding the ball, rather than merely touching it. But this only accelerated the violence. During that year, there were so many fights that the Rules Committee returned to the original wording of the rule, Naismith wrote. For a considerable chunk of basketball's adolescence, the problem was solved by erecting cages around the courts. A version of the current out-of-bounds rule wouldn't be established until 1913. But this obvious flaw didn't slow the sport's growth. You can tell that Naismith was thinking about exceptions, Zimmerman says of that first set of rules, trying to figure out the loopholes players will try to exploit. But the exploitation of rules is vital to a game's evolution. Essentially, everything related to basketball that isn't contained within its original 13 rules developed, because some player somewhere at some time fudged with them. Game designers encourage this type of behavior and establish conditions where players can freely experiment within and with the rules. These are called playtests, and they are used to gather feedback before a game is sold commercially. Basketball has been in the throes of an ongoing playtest for more than 100 years. The sport has always been fun to play, but it is worth watching because players are constantly experimenting within its constraints, bending or outright ignoring them when needed. That the game still manages to surprise us is a testament to its good design. The Ship of Theseus is an extremely straightforward thought experiment, as far as metaphysics goes. There is a boat. When its crew spots a few rusted bolts, they swap them out for fresh ones. Later, a rotted piece of the hull is pried free and they patch over the space with a new plank. This process gets repeated over time until, one day, each and every component of the ship has been replaced. Is it still the same boat? It's a fun little parable that can apply to all types of scenarios, hence my propensity to blurt out, "Ah, yes, just like the Ship of Theseus," whenever I happen to find myself in a conversation about philosophy. It doesn't always track, but Francisco Javier López Frías understands what I'm getting at. Frías teaches kinesiology and philosophy at Penn State and dedicates much of his research to understanding ethical and philosophical quandaries as they relate to sports. We're talking about basketball, and I've been trying to reconcile the sport we watch today with the one Naismith invented in 1891. It is highly unlikely the two would ever be mistaken for each other, but we nevertheless understand them to be materially one and the same. What exactly makes basketball basketball? The whole thing is a little confusing. You know, just like the ship of Theseus. It's not just basketball. Most sports undergo observable changes over time. Frias mentions soccer, which sprouted from various ancient games but is still evolving. When he watches matches from the 1950s and 1960s, he can't ignore that they appear to be, by his estimation, at least 80% different from their modern iterations. How do we determine that that sport is still soccer? Some philosophers take the nominalistic route with this quandary. We give that sport a name, and as long as people identify it with that name and call it that name, then it is that sport, Frias says. I don't agree with that position. The approach is a pretty simplistic one, and we're not even taking into account the obvious wrinkle that soccer is known as football pretty much everywhere else in the world. Consider that an own goal for nominalism. My take on it would be that soccer is still soccer, or basketball is still basketball, because the basic set of skills, or the basic set of experiences, are still the same, he says. In basketball, you have to pass and shoot in order to score more points than the opponent. In soccer, you still have to kick the ball around and combine with your teammates. The number of teammates or number of players on the field can vary depending on the type of soccer you are playing. But the basic abilities, or the basic experiences upon which the sport is built, are the same ones. Frias argues this maintains cohesion, not just over time, but across skill sets as well. You can look at pickup friendly games, you can look at high-level professional games. You ask practitioners, players. They all are going to tell you that one of the reasons why they engage with the sport is because that sport provides them with the experiences they cannot find anywhere else, he says. There are the things you have to do with your body, I call them embodied or bodied experiences, that you can only get in a specific sport. It is based on those experiences that we try to manage the rules or try to adjust the sport, so we can get more valuable or richer experiences. Someone blessed with a more refined philosophical mind than my own would perhaps use this moment to peel away the layers of this metaphysical onion known as experience. But I'm still stuck on the boat thing. What if the rudder is not merely replaced, but upgraded? What if its cloth sails are swapped out for ones made from durable polymers? What if? I don't know any other nautical terms. Even though the different parts of the ship have changed, it is still the ship, Frias says. The question is it the same ship? He takes the briefest of pauses before answering his own query. If the people who have made the changes to the ship still think about the ship as being the same ship, and nothing essential has changed, well, it is roughly the same ship. I would say the same thing about the sport. You don't need to understand all the specific things that make basketball basketball. You just need to appreciate how they work together. When Naismith wrote his book, he proudly stated that the fundamental principles on which the game was founded remained intact. When the question is asked, what is the biggest change in basketball? It is easy for me to answer. There is no doubt in my mind that it is the skill of the players and the kinds of plays that have been adopted. The boat may have looked different after all that time, but Naismith still recognized it as the one he had built. He didn't much object to the direction in which it was sailing, either. Let's talk about Naismith's book for a moment. Basketball, Its Origin and Development, was published in December 1941 to coincide with the 50th anniversary of the sport's invention. You may notice that this is the same month the Empire of Japan attacked Pearl Harbor and thrust the United States into World War II. With America at the fulcrum of history, James Naismith's little book about basketball wound up getting completely ignored. It was a tough break for a first-time author who had spent his final years putting the details of his legacy to paper. The text is concise and clear, though that is a clue that Naismith didn't write it himself. In the introduction to a 1996 edition, history professor William J. Baker writes that Naismith was literally disinclined and that his spelling and grammar were poor. Naismith's oldest son, Jack, attempted to transcribe the memoir for him, but couldn't deal with his father's meandering, repetitive speaking style and, instead, outsourced the task to one of his English professors for $150. She is not credited by name anywhere in the text. Despite her help, basketball, its origin and development, feels a little lopsided in parts. There is no mention of the score from that first ever game, but there is a lengthy section later in the book featuring data from a 1925 high school basketball tournament, included in which is a detailed table documenting the teenager's urinalysis results. Naismith's assistant and Mr. C.E. Rowe collected samples from every winning team over a four-day span. His work was invaluable, Naismith recalls. I mention all this because while his book purports to be the definitive story of the earliest days of basketball, it is actually a heavily edited retelling that's twice removed from its original source. It serves as a decent metaphor for basketball itself, a sport that, in its current form, looks absolutely nothing like the game Naismith invented. I realize that I have been a little tough on our old friend James. I've described him as a barely literate fabulist, and that is a terribly unfair assessment. Naismith was, by all accounts, a kind-hearted man who was genuinely concerned about the education and well-being of young people. In fact, basketball's popularity is a direct result of his generous and egalitarian nature. Were he just a hair less humble, he would have exerted more ownership over the invention and stifled its growth. He never patented his game and expressed no interest in making money from it. When a lawyer suggested he could claim a percentage of the profits from tickets sold to every basketball game, Naismith chased the man out of his office. Naismith will slowly fade in the rear view as we venture beyond the environs of the Springfield YMCA. This is a shame, as I've grown rather fond of him. He was a delightfully odd man. The kind of sweet eccentric who brought his dog along on his honeymoon. The honeymoon took place aboard a 22-foot boat, and both wife and dog were seasick for the entire trip. Here's another example of just how weird James Naismith was. Despite inventing basketball, he only played the sport two times in his entire life. His team in one of those games, the YMCA Teachers, lost 5-1. Their lone basket came from Naismith's friend, A.A. Stagg, a man who would go on to become a pioneer of American football. Naismith and his wife Maud invented an early flannel version of the football helmet. It was an attempt to prevent cauliflower ear, an ailment Naismith picked up while playing center for the YMCA training school's gridiron squad. When University of Kansas was looking for a director for its physical education department in 1898, Stagg suggested Naismith, whom he described as the inventor of basketball, medical doctor, Presbyterian minister, teetotaler, all-around athlete, non-smoker, and owner of a vocabulary without cuss words. Naismith also agreed to coach University of Kansas's basketball team, even though he thought players should be left to their own devices while on the court. He called coaches who micromanaged evil, and he more or less allowed his team to do as they pleased. He refereed many of his own team's games during those early years and was unflinchingly fair. Kansas lost a good number of these self-officiated contests, including the university's first ever game, a 16-5 defeat to the Kansas City YMCA. Their opponents played rough, but when Naismith called fouls on them, the young men from Kansas City told him he was mistaken and then kept on playing without punishment. In his final year as head coach, an article in the University Daily Kansan questioned his commitment to success. Dr. James Naismith, the inventor of the game, is so busy with his work as athletic director that he rarely finds time to give the men thorough training. He never thought winning was all that important, and his record during his 9-season run as Kansas's coach reflected this. 55 wins, 60 losses. Kansas became a basketball powerhouse soon after Naismith stepped away from the sidelines. According to Rob Rain's biography of Naismith, he spent his post-coaching years teaching and working on medical experiments. These included a sobriety tester and a proprietary method for determining whether or not someone was a natural athlete. According to a former student, Naismith blindfolded his subjects, clogged their ears, and put them behind the wheel of a car. If they could sustain a speed of 35 miles per hour, that meant they had a great kinesthetic sense. Read into this what you will. But Naismith himself was a terrible driver, with or without the blindfold. Naismith also invented a medieval rack-like machine that he believed would make people taller. He told the school newspaper that babies between the ages of 5 months and 1 year should be stretched on the device. His only concern, he said, was that the children may never stop growing. Unlike his baby torturing machine, basketball actually works. It's a stupendous invention, though it didn't gain him ubiquitous recognition as a household name. Once, when visiting his son in Iowa, Naismith popped into a gym at Morningside College to watch a pickup game. The boys needed a referee, and one suggested the quiet, bespectacled man with the center part for the job. "Come on, that old duffer never saw a game of basketball," exclaimed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.